I'm Patricia Van Haren, and I'm a family law attorney and the author of How to File and Survive a Divorce in California. And today I am joined with a special guest.
Oh, great. Thanks for having me, Patricia. My name is David Consigli. I'm a certified public accountant. I have a credential in business valuation called the ABV, Accredited in Business Valuation, which is a credential given by the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants, CPAs. And I'm also a certified divorce financial analyst. And I am the director of business valuation and litigation support at AAF CPAs in Boston, Massachusetts.
I know a lot of my clients will come into my office and they are concerned that maybe their spouse is hiding money or they don't know how to read the various financial documents that they're seeing from a spouse. And a lot of times they're really confused about what is a forensic accountant, what does a forensic accountant do? And more importantly, when do you need a forensic accountant in a divorce case?
Most spouses I run into think at some point or at some level that there is some misappropriations going on. We'll say that. You know, a lot of times where we are brought in when people think that maybe their spouse is not recording all their income, maybe they have a different bank account or assets in different places, in real extreme cases, totally hiding assets, totally misappropriating money, and just really not being upfront. So, you know, if you suspect this happens, or when your clients suspect this happens, it's always good to have a forensic accountant take a look at it, maybe take a look at some bank statements or things that the client has already provided, things like tax returns. Often we can look at those and see if they're being reported on the financial statement. And most people will give a free consultation to say, yes, I think there might be some improprieties going on here, or maybe, but really not enough to justify the cost of doing a full forensic engagement.
I have a lot of clients that are business owners. And as you know, businesses can have various incomes. And we look at a business, at least in California, in the property division part of a divorce, but also doing a cash flow analysis, deciding is there income available for support. With these business owners, sometimes we've got a major corporation, sometimes we've had a smaller corporation. So when do you feel like the clients need a business valuation done? And how can you work in business valuations?
Yeah, so there's two components to that. The number one, there's the income issue. So there's a lot of different type of entities. There's LLCs, LLPs, C corporation, S corporations, partnerships, sole proprietors. And oftentimes it's hard to tell what the owners are actually receiving in compensation. We've done numerous analysis and numerous engagements on really just income calculations. Also, to tie in the forensic piece, business owners sometimes are more apt not to be reporting income or have business expenses being deducted that may be personal in nature, which does two things, adds to the value of the business and actually adds income to the owner, right? Because they're getting these personal benefits. From the side of the valuation piece, really what we do, especially with the small ones, is try to determine whether the owner has a business or a job. And the first thing is to look at what are they taking for salary. If it's a sole proprietor and they're on a Schedule C, and let's say they're making $75,000 and that's what the net income of the business is. And yet if they were to go out and get a job, they would only make $75,000. Then really what they have is a job, not a business with value. Anything in excess of that salary would probably prompt a business valuation because there's excess. It's really a return of capital as opposed to just wages and a fair wage. So oftentimes we'll take a look at the business, see if there's anything in excess of the wages and more of a return of capital, which would contemplate having a business valuation done.
I do a lot of work in the mediation arena, the collaborative arena, and I know you are also collaboratively trained as a financial neutral. And I'd like you to explain a little bit. A lot of people will come into my office and say, well, if you're the attorney, why do I need a financial neutral? How is that going to help me to achieve a settlement in this case, what is the role of a financial neutral, either in a collaborative divorce process or a mediation?
First thing to understand with a financial neutral is what the name says is neutral. So we come in as a financial advisor, as a neutral party, helping both people come to some type of settlement. The job of the financial neutral is not to tell the clients how to divide their assets. It's not to tell the clients what support payments should be, or either alimony or child support. The job of the financial neutral is to come in and run options for the client and let the client determine what options they want or what options they need to be able to settle the case. To answer your question about why would I need a financial neutral if I have an attorney, well, you know, attorneys are really good at the law, and I'm not saying that attorneys can't help run the same scenarios that financial neutrals have. Some can. It may be a higher rate, may not be, but it's much more efficient for the professional that does this every day to be able to do this and do it in an efficient manner, and to be able to run those scenarios to help the people come close the gap between their differences.
I know for my cases, I really prefer it when I have all those options provided to me by the financial neutral. And like you said, I can sit there and I can look at the tax returns and I can look at the bank statements, but it's going to be a much higher rate and not the same level of competence, because my specialty is the law. That's why I really like that I have you as part of my team.
It's really about efficiency, right? I mean, there's a lot of things that we could all figure out because we're professionals and we know how to research things. But when you do it over and over again, you know, it just becomes second nature, and you're much more confident in what you're doing. You know, if it's something you're not familiar with, you know, there's a little bit of doubt that creeps in. And certainly as an attorney, attorneys don't want any doubt to be creeping into their clients' heads, right?
That is absolutely true. How can I get people to get in touch with you?
You know, my cell phone is always with me, and that number is 508-330-4513. Email me at dconsigli, dconsigli at aafcpa.com.
Thank you.
Thank you.